So Sally's already given you my title. One thing I do have to do is tell you my disclosure. I have no huge industry speaking gigs, consultation fees, stock options, expensive lunches, free pens, or any other conflicts to disclose. And sadly, I have to say that. So I have nothing to disclose. All right. So I have what I typically like to do is give a couple of quick sound bites. And before I get to fentanyl, I'm going to spend just a few moments talking about opiates in general and perhaps putting us all on the same page in terms of understanding that opiates as a class have revolutionized medicine. So they're not bad drugs. They oftentimes are used in an incorrect way, and they can cause an awful lot of problems when used improperly. But they do mimic our naturally occurring opiates in our system, the endorphins. So they do simulate the exact same things that our bodies are producing. They work through receptors, the mu, kappa, delta, nociception. And there is tolerance that develops. And tolerance means that you need to take a higher dose in order to achieve the desired effect. That contributes an awful lot to some of the problem. If we didn't develop tolerance, there'd be no need to escalate the dose, and the likelihood of overdoses would go down. And I just again want to point out they remain one of the most valuable drugs for treating cough, pain, and diarrhea. Heroin is probably still the most widely abused illicit opiate. Withdrawal can be very, very bad, very dysphoric. It is not life-threatening. People go through opiate withdrawal all the time and do not die, unlike alcohol withdrawal or barbiturate or benzodiazepine withdrawal. Naloxone and naltrexone are specific receptor antagonists, and I'll show you how they work because they are the mainstay of how we treat, and also naloxone in particular in the form of Narcan is our number one tool for reviving someone who has had an overdose. Methadone, you've all probably heard an awful lot about it. I will not be talking about methadone, but just so that you know that methadone maintenance has been the historical treatment to maintain people who are dependent. It has given way to buprenorphine, which is one of the drugs that when I was at the Addiction Research Center at NIDA, I helped develop this buprenorphine, which you might know it now as Suboxone. An awful lot of people have opiate dependence. Only 10% receive treatment. These designer opiates, and now I'm getting into the meat of these fentanyls, the major cause of overdoses, because it's often mixed. So these, again, are still sound bites. I'm giving you the headliners of what we're going to be talking about. Oxycontin is a diverted legal opiate. As it turns out, fentanyl is diverted in its form of patches, but it's also made in clandestine laboratories. And I'm going to share with you how that's done in a little bit, so you get an idea of why fentanyl has stayed under the radar for as long as it has. All right, misuse of prescription, second only to marijuana, and the annual average number of people using pain relievers exceeds the number of new marijuana users. All right, so here's some sobering statistics. Death from overdose, I don't think I need to reiterate this, but in 2020, last year that we've got really good data, over 93,000 people died of opiate overdose in the United States. That's 255 a day, and approximately 600,000 die worldwide. And so this now exceeds that caused by automobile accidents. And we've learned that excessive prescriptions are the leading source. We are working on that. And in fact, in 2018, Massachusetts was the leader in curtailing the number of opiate prescriptions. We're down to 35.3 for every 100 persons. That is one of the lowest out there. So we're doing a great job. The only sentence that I want to focus on here is this middle one right here. Properly disposing of all unused prescription medications. When we're done tonight, please do me a favor. Go to your medicine cabinets in your bathrooms and open them up, or the drawers or whatever. And if you have any unused prescription medications that you no longer need, let's say you had wisdom teeth pulled out, or you had, you know, a procedure on a hand done, and you were given some Oxycontin or something else like that, and you didn't use them all, and you're keeping them in case you might need it. I can tell you right now, that is one of the number one ways teens get access to prescription opiates, is in their own house. So please do me a favor. Go in and dispose of them. Don't throw them down the toilet. Almost every one of the pharmacies has a drug return policy. You can go into one of their safes and drop them off. Please do that, because teens know to root out. And in fact, anybody who comes to your house There's a lot of them. I sat on a panel one time, and I had on either side of me recovered opiate dependent individuals, and they told me they love going to parties. The first place they went is asked to go to the bathroom, and they went through the medicine cabinet looking for unused medication. One of the big things. All right, the tsunami. I apologize for the wave. It doesn't mean that Concord Carlisle has so much fentanyl in it that I'm worried about it. The word tsunami in this case is referring to the strength of fentanyl and why it got all of our attention. And that's what I'm going to share with you tonight. So this is the, how you pronounce it. This is the definition: an arrival or occurrence of something in overwhelming quantities or amounts. And the loss of human lives from this latest tsunami is staggering. And it is true. It is causing a great deal of problems with us. These are the overdose deaths in the United States. We got very, very excited in 2018. We were starting to make a dent. We were very thrilled that our education programs were showing a dip. Then unfortunately, 2019 and 2020, and of course, all of you know what happened here. We had the COVID crisis and we saw another skyrocket. And there's a lot of data to suggest that not only alcohol use, other illicit drug use, and including fentanyl, heroin, all went up during the crisis, the COVID crisis. Now, this is what I wanted to point out. If you look at this, you can see, and this slide tells you something about what's going on. It's not a popular position. I don't get a lot of praise when I show this slide because not everybody likes to see this. But this is the prescription opiate, the natural and semi-synthetics and methadone in the blue line. Notice what's happening to that. It's dipping down. That is because we got a handle on the prescriptions. Now, by removing the access to OxyContin and related, what have we done? We have inadvertently created a vacuum that has allowed the synthetic opiates to skyrocket. So in a way, our success in reducing OxyContin and related prescription opiates to bring those down has paved the way for these synthetics. And even heroin shot up, but even heroin started to go down just a little bit. Why is that? Fentanyl is wicked, wicked cheap to make. And we'll get to that. All right, and this is just the same numbers for Massachusetts, showing you again how the synthetic opiates have just skyrocketed. If you go on the CDC, you'll see posters like this. I highly recommend you download one of these. These are really, really well done. I'm gonna go through all of these details in a minute. I just wanted to give a shout out to the CDC. They do a great job of producing this kind of literature. The National Institute on Drug Abuse, another shout out to them. They put together a huge number of posters, cards, talking points for all of these drugs. Very briefly, where's the fentanyl coming from? It's almost all coming from China. But interestingly enough, a lot of the precursors in New Mexico are going to Mexico, being made in clandestine labs, and then are being brought back into the United States from Mexico. It is very easy to bring this stuff in. It's so potent, you don't need an awful lot of it. That is why it's so hard to detect. And I'll show you some of those slides in a few minutes. Some quick terminology. If you hear me see the word opium, I'm talking about the juice of the poppy pod. The endorphins, we've talked a little bit about them. Those are those endogenous opiate-like peptides that every one of us right now have them floating around in our brain. And if you're having dessert right now, if you're eating some chocolate cake, I guarantee your endorphin levels are shooting sky high. But my endorphins are going pretty high because I enjoy this kind of stuff and chatting with you all. So I got my own little high going on right here. The opiate receptor, these are the proteins on the surface of neurons to which the opiates bind and produce their effect. This is critical. This is critical for understanding fentanyl and how we are going to combat it. A narcotic, I hate this word. The federal government uses the term narcotic across the board. In fact, they call cocaine a narcotic. That's how useless this term is. I include it because it is a historical term. A lot of people know what it is. Some people think it's referring to opiates. It is not. The opiates and opioids. Opiate technically is any drug that is derived directly from opium. That would be morphine, codeine, and papaverin. That's it. Opioids are the term for semi-synthetic or synthetic drugs that bind to the opiate receptor. So all the oxycodones, the hydromorphones, heroin is a synthetic. It's made from morphine. And of course, fentanyl and its derivatives. And these are the synthetic opioids and the prescriptions. The main difference is The fentanyl and others are mostly man-made in clandestine laboratories, where the prescription opiates are pharmaceutical-grade opiates and the actual pills that are then diverted. And that's where the OxyContin and OxyContin issue went through. Very quickly, what are the medical uses? This is why people get a prescription for opiates. In the United States, it's almost always for pain and cough. In other countries where dysentery is prominent, opiates save thousands and thousands of lives a year from terrible, terrible dehydration, loss of fluids because of massive amounts of diarrhea. They are very good at treating those three elements. But what's interesting about these opiates is that they interact with those receptors and produce a state of euphoria. All right, I'll come back to that in a second. So pain, most common experience, chronic pain lasting more than 3 months. This is where you might have a prescription for an opiate in your medicine cabinet. Typically not for chronic pain, but again, if you do have a prescription, make sure that they're locked up. And trust me, folks, put them in that little bottle just doesn't do it. They need to be locked up in a cabinet. Those childproof bottles are not any good for anyone over the age of 12. They can open those up. Two types, nociceptive and neuropathic. Some of you may have even had a neuropathic. It's caused by damage of the nervous system from trauma or injury. If you've been in a car accident, that might be a neuropathic pain. The nociceptive, the first one is a physiological process. Even after a surgery, those are the kinds of pain that you see. And this is the pathway. And I just wanted to point out that the opiates work in a couple different places. They alter your perception of the pain. And one of the most unique things about opiates, this is why they're so appealing to many people, is that they will know that they have pain. They will recognize it. They have a sensation, but they don't care about it. They actually, it dulls the sensation. So the opiates work down here in the spinal cord. So we have delta receptors down here that will block the pain signals coming in at the spinal cord, which is why they're very, very good for chronic low pain. And then they're also good for controlling the perception of the pain. In contrast, your non-steroidal anti-inflammatories like aspirin and acetaminophen, they work out here in the periphery. They do not work centrally, which also tells you why they're good in combining them too. So you may get combination products because they work in two different mechanisms. And just to give you an idea, this is how we measure pain. I use visual analog scales in the laboratory, and somebody just puts a mark there. For children, little ones, we'll give them this to rate their pain, and they can use the little face here to try to identify how bad their pain happens to be. There's an emotion component, and there's an intensity component, and it has a character component. And what's interesting is the opiates will work on all of those. Intense cough. Again, if you've ever had such an intense cough that you feel as though a lung is actually going to come out of your body, that's the kind of intense cough that I'm talking about, where you can actually cause massive damage to the inner lining of your lungs. That's the kind of cough that the opiates will suppress very well. And I already mentioned the chronic diarrhea. Now, why are these drugs abused? Well, opiates have this ability to produce an immediate sense of pleasure, well-being, or euphoria. And it stimulates our own endogenous reward circuitry. There's nothing magical about this. This is one of my favorite times of year. I love the fall. I love it when the leaves change, even though I had to rake them this weekend. I was out there for 2.5 hours raking leaves. But you know, I still every once in a while stood back and took a look at some of the trees that hadn't completely fallen. When you get up tomorrow and it's a sunny day, take a look out there and imagine the pleasure, assuming that you like fall. But imagine that little pleasure, the joy that you have in recognizing nature in its most purest form. Imagine for a moment not being able to feel that. That is the kind of effect that opiates can rekindle in people's brains for whatever reason. And there's a lot, and I'm not really going to get into it. There's a whole bunch of psychiatric issues that we can talk about, obviously from the pain processes, but these opiates are able to hijack your own reward center and make you feel good no matter what else is going around you. You may have had part of your colon removed. You may have had to have a leg amputated, massive amounts of pain, and yet they are capable of making you feel okay about that. And we get these other rushes. All right, let's get into the heart of it now. So that was the introduction, so that we're all on the same page. Know your fentanyl. Fentanyl is a Schedule II drug. Schedule II drugs mean that they are highly likely to be abused, but they do have recognized medicinal value. So other drugs, you might be surprised, morphine, opium, codeine, hydrocodone, hydromorphone, that's Dilaudid, methadone is Dolphine, meperidine, you may know it as Demerol, oxycodone, which is also called OxyContin, Percocet, and cocaine. Those are all Schedule II drugs because they have medicinal value. A Schedule I drug would be something like heroin and methamphetamine, you know, and some of the cathinone derivatives, things that have no accepted medicinal value. The combination, I alluded to this, the hydrocodone plus acetaminophen is also known as Vicodin. And many physicians are prescribing this because you can reduce the dose of hydrocodone, reduce the likelihood of exposure to an opiate by adding acetaminophen. And those two together, because in that previous slide I showed you, they work by different mechanisms. This is why they can control pain a little bit better and not put you in as great a risk for developing dependence on an opiate. All right, so what's fentanyl? It is a medicine. It was designed initially for end-of-life pain management in cancer patients, but it's a powerful, powerful synthetic opiate. It's very similar to morphine, 50 to 100 times more potent. That means 50 to 100 times less of the drug is needed in order to produce the same effect. We do have an injectable form. We use it in surgical procedures and managing pain. But because of this, it's also only reserved for high potency, high efficacy in serious pain. So I put the next couple of slides are going to show you actual products. I'm not endorsing any one of these. There are various products. I just wanted to give you a flavor of what sorts of products, what they might look like. Fentanyl for injection, this is one particular brand. It comes in either a little ampule, which is broken in the emergency room, and you take a syringe and suck it up. You can also insert a syringe into this little vial and it can be injected. Look at the dose, 100 micrograms. And you heard me correct, 100 micrograms. What's a usual dose of acetaminophen? Anybody know? Well, sorry, you're all muted. I'm gonna answer for you. 500 milligrams for acetaminophen. A typical dose of morphine might be 10 milligrams. We're looking at 100 micrograms and you may only give half of that dose. All right, the fentanyl lozenge, Actigue. This is a lollipop kind of device. It's used for breakthrough pain. Kids get their hands on this and they'll run around and they'll suck on it. And you can get a very intense, very rapid rush effect from the fentanyl that's released inside the buccal pouch. To be honest, Sally, I don't know whether people can see me. Is my camera large enough? Can you see at all or not? You may
yes.
not.
Yes, you can be seen.
Okay, so I'm just going to go up close. Please don't be grossed up by this. But inside, if you take your finger and do this, look inside your cheek mouth, in between where your gums and your cheek meet, is called the buccal pouch. You have a tremendous number of blood vessels there. When you suck on a sucker like this, the fentanyl is almost instantaneously absorbed. This is why it works for breakthrough pain. There's also a nasal spray, not as common, but it is out there. The fentanyl patch, we are going to come back to this. This has a very special issue with me. Because I see it. I also do a lot of consulting forensic toxicology cases. And a lot of times I get involved with fentanyl overdoses. Almost always it has to do with the fentanyl patch. We will come back to that, but the concept is the same. You put this patch on your upper arm or your back and you get 24 hours of relief of pain. But you can imagine peeling that off and put it on somebody who's not tolerant, they can get the effects. It's a little more sluggish. Takes a little bit more time, nevertheless, just as effective. I've already said this, the injection, the potency, rapid onset effects. I'll talk a little bit about these. We're not seeing alfentanil and sufentanil very much. At the very end of the talk, I'll talk about carfentanil. It's 10,000 times more potent than morphine. We will come to that. That's one of my last couple of slides where I'm worried about this next tsunami that's even bigger and more challenging than fentanyl. Now fentanyl is metabolized in norfentanyl, it's inactive, and that's how we can detect how long ago somebody had fentanyl. FYI, you all probably remember, I can't tell how old any of you are. I'm guessing since you have children in high school, you probably remember the Moscow terrorist attack in 10/27/02. And in fact, there was a fentanyl, that's exactly what they injected into that area to take down the hostages. It was a gas formula mixed with halothane and it was a fentanyl analog. We don't know which one, but it was confirmed. And because they didn't let anybody know that that was the case, all those people's lives could have been saved with Narcan. All right, fentanyl patch. I promised to come back to it. This is a blown up view, side view, not true to scale. They're much smaller than this, but I blew it up like this so that you can see exactly what it is. There's an adhesive layer that has a permeable membrane on it. And then there's this rate controlling membrane. There's the backing, the plastic backing. And then there's this gel matrix to which the fentanyl is bound into it. Now, it makes perfect sense. The fentanyl can be absorbed through these pores, goes through your skin, and it causes a very slow release. That's its design. However, the problem is when people get their hands on this, they'll take a needle and they'll take the needle and stick it through this membrane and suck up the gel into the needle, and then they'll inject the fentanyl plus the gel. And that's one of the dangers. And this is the problem. Extremely dangerous because you can get high doses of it very, very quickly. And what people don't realize is that if you don't die of an overdose from the fentanyl, you'll die of thrombophlebitis because the veins cannot handle that gel. It's so viscous, it will go to your cardiac vessels and stop your heart. So double whammy on trying to inject the innards of a fentanyl patch. I already said that. And there's been a number of reports, and I know you're recording this. You can go back and take a look at these papers if you're interested in it, but this is the fatal intravenous misuse of fentanyl. So it is widely known in the medical profession. A number of papers have been studied. And as I mentioned, I've been on a number of cases in which fentanyl patches were in fact injected into the person and they died fairly quickly. And here's another one that the FDA has issued a warning about these actual deaths of patches using it. Okay, so now they do come, and again, I'm not promoting any particular brand here. This is the Mylan fentanyl transdermal patch. And the reason I like using this slide is it shows you different doses are created by the size of the patch. So you can immediately tell how much fentanyl is in a patch by its size. It also has it printed right on the side. So it is advertising exactly how much is in there. So if if a child gets their hands on it, they know immediately what's in it and they know immediately how much is there. So it does advertise what's in it. And the larger the patch, obviously the larger amount of fentanyl that is released per hour. Notice that it says 12 micrograms is released per hour, up to 100 micrograms per hour. So that's the highest dose there. Now, one thing I wanted to give a shout out that Duragesic, J&J has just announced that they are no longer manufacturing their Duragesic opioid patch. It was one of the most frequently abused patches out there. And rather than try to deal with it, they produced their last batch as of July 31st, 2021. So just to maintain continuity, but they stopped making it and stopped distributing because there is no way to beat that system. Some of the newer patches are set up with a different type of matrix. So it makes it very, very hard to pull the matrix of the gel up into a syringe. But the Duragesic type transdermal system was easy to bypass. All right, Atique, this is the lozenge. It's provided for breakthrough pain. And so patients on a cancer unit, they're usually on some kind of pain management system, but every once in a while they get a phenomenon known as breakthrough pain. For whatever reason, something's not working right, the blood levels of the morphine or whatever is they're treated with, they get this very profound breakthrough pain. That's where this product comes in mind, and they are given the lozenge. They call it a lollipop, and they suck on this end. This is the handle end. You hold on to it, and you stick this between your cheek and gum, and you get rapid absorption. Almost all of the opiates, in fact, all the opiates that I know of have a strong bitter taste, and so they have this very strong mild berry flavor on it to try to mask the taste. Unfortunately, that makes it more palatable to adolescents. Very briefly, in the 80s, alpha methyl fentanyl was out there. This was our first wave. It happened in the 80s. I remember it. I was a postdoctoral fellow in the 80s and actually was recruited to McLean Hospital, Harvard Medical School in 83. So right around that time, we got this first taste of what they were calling China White. that wave kind of died down. We didn't see anywhere near the amount that we're seeing now. MPTP was a number of heroin abusers who were trying to make their own a specialized high potency version of heroin. They screwed up in the lab. They made this analog of meperidine, and it actually produced overnight Parkinson's disease. And there's a whole literature on those individuals. And if any of you know anybody who has Parkinson's, you can imagine being fine one day, waking up the next day with full-blown Parkinson's symptoms. That's how dangerous some of these clandestine labs are, because they're not great chemists. And you can always screw up and make something that is rather deadly. These are some of the street names that you'll hear for fentanyl. Apace, China Girl, Chinatown, China White. Obviously, China's in there. That's where it's coming from. Dance Fever, Goodfellas, Great Bear, He-Man, Poison, and Tango and Cash. All right, this is what you're looking for, folks. It comes in a couple of different flavors. In a baggie like this, and I'll tell you right off the bat, I only know this is fentanyl because I saw the chemical analysis. If I look at this just on face value, first and foremost, I know it's not flour. I know it's not sugar. So you shouldn't be seeing this in the kitchen baking with it. But I'll be honest with you, it could be a mixture of crack cocaine. It could be some kind of a heroin. It's very, very hard to do this by sight, folks. Even the experts have a difficult time detecting the real things from the fake ones. So this is fentanyl powder. It can be mixed with fluid like saline or water and injected. But what usually has happened is this base fentanyl powder is then turned into these fentanyl pills. I'll show you how that's done in just a minute. This is one of the more common colors. We see this, it's actually not a bad color. It's a pleasant color. At least I like this color blue. But you notice there's some imprints on it. We'll get to that in a minute. There's a couple different types here. And here's another fentanyl lookalike. When I say the term lookalike, I mean it's a pill that is purposely designed to look like something else, but it's a Trojan horse. It is carrying deadly amounts of fentanyl, sometimes a combination of oxycodone. We've seen methamphetamine. We've seen high doses of dextromethorphan. And you might think, what's wrong with dextromethorphan? That's in Robitussin. That's in my cough medicine. Turns out dextromethorphan at very high doses is also very dangerous, especially when it's mixed. And I want to take a moment to just talk about that for a second. I'm going to move on and I'll show you more. But please understand that fentanyl by itself is a horrific problem to us. But kids today are not just doing fentanyl. They're doing fentanyl in combination with alcohol, in combination with marijuana, in combination with benzodiazepines like Valium and diazepam. So these lookalikes can look like anything. They're making them to make them look like Valium. And so kids can go out and buy a pill that they are told is Valium, and it's not. It's a lookalike that looks like Valium, but in fact, it's been made in a clandestine lab and it's got fentanyl in it. This is the kind of stuff that keeps me up at nights, thinking about people in their basement making this stuff. All right, this is what I'm referring to. This is one of the common ones that we notice. It's got these trade names, these markings on it with the 30 on it, these markings. They're trying to mimic other pills that look like this. So V48 is one of the bigger ones that we, in the A215. But guess what? As soon as the DEA recognizes this, the people who are making them change the dye on their little press and they make a different one and they change the color. I didn't make fentanyl. I apologize. When I was in graduate school, I went to some work in the School of Pharmacy and I learned how to make pills. We're making our own little morphine tablets to study dissolution rates and how we can make a long-acting version of morphine. And this was back in 1975. So I learned how to use one of these devices I'm about to share with you. All right, so I think I already said this. Again, the rationale, why do anybody mix and match drugs? Well, sometimes it's just to boost the product, to increase the cost. Here's the thing, somebody comes to a child or even to an adult and says, hey, I got this new benzodiazepine, but it's got a little kick to it. It's a little stronger. They've added fentanyl to it. It doesn't contain Valium. Valium on the street sometimes can go for as much as $20 a pill. They can get a fentanyl lookalike for about $1 and mark it up to 20. So there's your markup value. That's one of the appeals to why these clandestine labs are so lucrative for people. They can turn massive product profits on this product because it is so cheap. So it is cheaper to make your own and try to sell it off as something else that people will pay for. But you get this extra boost, this extra kick. And as long as someone's tolerant to the opiates and they can handle it, they won't have any problem. But unfortunately, that's not always the case. Now what we're seeing are people are pressing the tablets to look like oxycodone or OxyContin. So beware of that. And here's what it looks like. Here's the pill press. You can buy one of these on eBay for about $1,300. Now, of course, I would not give this same talk to your children, just so you know. I'm giving this information to you because if you see something like this in your house, you should know what this is. All right. It's not a common product. These are the types of dyes. There are thousands of these. I just picked one slide off the internet to show you a sample of the different types of dye. Here's a little Batman. Here's a star. Here's a little smiley face eating things. Here's a longhorn. Here's Superman. You notice it's inverted. Here's a Chevrolet. I'm sure Chevrolet is happy about that. A shamrock or radiation. It doesn't matter. People, you can make these dyes into anything, which is why they can masquerade as almost any drug out there. That, again, is one of the other dangers. Here's a number one message that you give to your teens. Do not consume any pill that you do not directly receive from a pharmacy or your prescriber or you, their parent. Pills purchased online are not safe. I don't even go to online pharmacies. I know I shouldn't say that. They're supposed to be safe. I like to look at the pharmacist, look him or her in the eye and say, yep, that's my prescription. And I take it home and I lock it up. That's what I do. That's just me. But I don't want to take any chances at all of any kind of diversion. And the trouble is you can order almost all these things from out of the United States and have them sent to you. All right. This is not meant to scare you. This is simply meant to show you the similarity of the structures. This is morphine up here. With two minor changes, you turn it into heroin. Now, fentanyl doesn't look like these guys at all. It looks like methadone. And I didn't really talk too much about methadone. And I did my dissertation on methadone and morphine. Methadone is a wickedly potent opiate. It's far more potent than morphine. But we give it orally. When taken orally, it's a very slow release and doesn't produce as much of the effects. But you modify this structure, take this methadone as your starting structure, and you turn it into fentanyl. All of a sudden now, it's very, very effective. And it's very potent and very deadly. Now, just to show you, we will coming back to naloxone. This is also called Narcan. Many of you have probably heard that term. Look at how close this structure resembles that of morphine. And I'll show you how that works in just a minute. The pharmacology. The opiates affect all of it. I've only talked so much about the brain and we talked a little bit about respiration. It has an impact on all of your organ systems. Some of these are indirect. If individuals start sharing needles, you'll see hepatitis, the immune system, nervous system. The heart lining can be affected very quickly. That's euphoria. It's ecstatic. It comes on very fast and more intense than heroin. It's because it is so potent. It goes immediately to the brain. Your brain gets 20% of every time your heart pumps. And because it is so lipophilic, that means fat soluble. It jumps across that blood-brain barrier and attaches itself to those opiate receptors in your brain and does not let go. That is why it is so rapid acting, why it is so potent. Another thing, this is for you. Telltale signs, pupillary constriction. This is one of the effects that the person does not develop tolerance to. Here's someone's normal pupils. When they're under the influence of opiates, you get this pinpoint or pupillary constriction. I'm gonna come back to respiratory depression in a minute and not so much gastrointestinal. We will come to respiratory depression in a few minutes. Pupillary constriction, the reason I mention this is something that you can see outright. It's very difficult to miss this. Here's a better view of it. The opiates will cause a pinpoint pupil. Marijuana, cocaine, or crack will sometimes cause this rending of the eye. And you can usually have some kind of a mixed size of the pupil. And then the amphetamines, cocaine, crack, hallucinogens, and some opiates will do this. Very few, though, usually when they're going through withdrawal. So you can see dilated pupils, somewhat red eye, but normal pupils, but this pinpoint pupil is a telltale sign. Now, respiratory depression. This is what causes an awful lot of problems. One of the unique things about opiates is that they suppress respiration. And what it does is it works directly on the brain. You have a center in the brainstem. It's right about here. If you could see where I'm pointing on my finger, go in the back of your ear and go right about here, right in this area here of the brainstem. There's a center so that you don't have to think about breathing. I mean, you are now because I'm asking you, think about your breathing. Inhale, exhale, inhale, exhale, right? How awful would that be if you had to think every time you took a breath? Well, luckily your brain does that for you. And your brain reacts to carbon dioxide. So your brain is picking up increases amounts of carbon dioxide and it stimulates you to breathe. Well, fentanyl blocks that sensitivity. That's how it works. So instead of taking 12 to 20 breaths per minute, you're now taking 4 to 5 a minute. That's how it starts. Nausea and vomiting, we'll see that a lot, reduced libido. Here's the physiologic signs. These are, again, having any one of these does not automatically mean you've got a heroin user or a fentanyl user, but in the aggregate, you will see things like tiny pinpoints, large pupils when they're withdrawing, and they will kick when they're dependent. Dark circles or puffiness, very heavy eyelids, droopy face, hacking cough if they're smoking it. Burn marks, nosebleeds, track marks. I'm going to show you what that looks like in a minute. Scabs from skin picking and sometimes flu symptoms. All right. Sorry for the how graphic this is, folks, but you do need to see this. This is what track marks look like. So if you're looking at the screen, these are fresh ones. You see that's got a scab on it. Very fresh. This is a very recent. These ones here, these are older. They've turned brown. The brown is actually bilirubin that's left from bleeding underneath the skin. The bruising is when they miss a vein. Many of you have had your blood taken at the doctor's office, right? That's where that comes from. Other locations, I kid you not, when I was in the opiate treatment center at Baltimore City Hospitals, I could not believe the lengths that these opiate-dependent people would go to, injecting between their toes, in their scrotum, in the penis, inside the groin. The last thing I want to share with you is skin popping. When individuals run out of their veins, they can't mainline. So they stick the needles underneath the skin and it causes these abscesses. In this slide here, you can see this scarring. This is what skin popping looks like. And so again, people will go to great lengths. They'll start wearing long sleeve shirts. They won't let you see them in short sleeve shirts. All right, how to spot someone. Tired, isolation, appetite changes, looking disheveled, increased debts, avoiding obligations. You'll have drug paraphernalia, needles. Again, any one of these by themselves, you're looking for in the aggregate. The fentanyl tolerance develops to pretty much everything, but not to respiration. And unfortunately, the lethal effects only require about 4 to 8 times the dose. That is a low therapeutic index. Most drugs that you get from the pharmacy, you might need to take 50 to 100 times more to get a toxic reaction. So this is not very safe. Now, how toxic is fentanyl? This is it. This is a lethal dose of fentanyl. I've blown up old Abe here, one of my favorite presidents. And this is the amount of fentanyl that will kill a human being relative to a penny. There it is. Now, fentanyl isn't even on this scale. Just to give you an idea, marijuana, LSD, psilocybin, some of these other drugs. Here's heroin, intravenous, 5. Remember what I said, can be over 100 times more potent. It's not even, I can't even get on this scale here. That's how lethal it is relative to alcohol. All right, let's talk a little bit about Narcan. This is a little animation. I just put this together this past weekend just for this presentation. So you're seeing this, you're the only people who have ever seen this animation. So I just made this up. So here's morphine. Just imagine it looks like that structure that I showed you. This is the opiate receptor on a brain neuron. And so what morphine does is it doesn't always dance like that. I got a little crazy with the animation. I apologize for that. Morphine does not really do that kind of a dance. But once it binds to the receptor, it produces a desired effect. And then it comes off the receptor and the effects go away. All right. Now, here we go. We've got the opiate on board. And let's say the person is having trouble breathing. Well, now we can reverse that with Narcan. Remember, I showed you the structure. It looks a lot like morphine, but it's a little different. So here's the Narcan. doesn't look exactly like morphine. And so it comes in here and it just kind of bumps the morphine right off of the receptor. And then the effects go away. That's the way it's supposed to work. And that's the way it works every time. Now, we got fentanyl. Fentanyl, as you recall, the structure looks very different. And I've taken some latitude with it, some artistic pleasure in working with this purple color here. Again, playing with my palette. Again, this was probably at 2 a.m. on a Saturday night when I was doing this. So please, I hope it works. I'm pretty sure this animation will work. All right, here's fentanyl. Bingo, does the same sort of thing, binds to the receptor. And now the arrow is much larger. Why? Because it sticks to that receptor, will not come off, and produces a very profound analgesic and respiratory depression. Let's shift fast forward. Now the person is in respiratory distress. Ah, there we go. Very intense. Let's get our old buddy now, Narcan. Well, what happens with naloxone? Because fentanyl binds to the receptor so strongly, that first dose of Narcan kind of bounces off. Oh, this worked pretty well. Let's see. This one bounces off. Now maybe the third one. Ah, third one's a charm and knocks the fentanyl off finally. And then the effects go away. And then the Narcan binds to those other receptors trying to prevent. So the take-home message here is that Narcan will indeed reverse a fentanyl overdose, but it may take 2, sometimes 3 doses in order to do it, depending on the dose of fentanyl. And this is it. It's a primary rescue operation. It is a life or death situation. You need to administer an opioid receptor antagonist such as naloxone right away. These are the signs. If you see somebody experience loss of consciousness, unresponsive, awake but unable to talk, breathing is very slow and shallow and erratic. Let me show you what it sounds like, folks, because I've seen it. Sadly, I've seen this. This is what it looks like. It's not, please understand, someone does not inject fentanyl and then dies immediately like that. They do not go to ground. There is this progression, and this is what the breathing looks like. I'm going to simulate it for you. It looks like this. So you notice that I can't pause it quite as long. I used to be able to hold my breath a lot longer, but you notice that pause, that rasping, they call it the death rattle. That's what it sounds like. It looks like a choking sound. It does sound like a snore-like gurgling. It has a very characteristic sound when you hear it. The face is pale. Their fingernails, look at their fingernails, and their lips will turn blue before the rest of their skin does. Most people do not turn blue like my slides do. But you'll see it in the lips and the fingernail. This is the presentation. I think I already said that. All right. And these are the reasons. This is the concern. They're tolerant of the usual dose, but they cannot tolerate the fentanyl. This is our rescue. It is not orally absorbed, which is good because oral absorption is very slow. Naloxone works by intramuscular, intravenous, or intranasal. Subcutaneous is kind of slow. I don't prefer that. We prefer intranasal because almost anybody can shoot something up somebody's nose. Not everyone is good at giving a shot. It is not good for long-term maintenance because it's too short-acting. Naloxone gets metabolized within 30 minutes. It's gone. So you have just enough time to get the ENTs there so you can administer naloxone in your home or you come across them, and there's enough time, assuming someone's called 911, to get them to an emergency room where they'll put them on a slow drip. Now, I did this experiment in 1976, just to prove to you, in a rat. I apologize for sharing this with you, but this rat, we were actually trying to see how fast we could reverse it. This is how rapid it works. Here's an overdose of I didn't have fentanyl at the time. We only were studying morphine. This is the change in EEG pattern. We got an overdose. This is where I injected naloxone, 1 mg/kg IV. Look how fast that rat recovered. Look how fast it is. It is a lifesaver. We have 3 formulations, the intranasal atomizer, which has been recalled, the auto-injectable, Esvio, and the prepackaged nasal spray or Narcan, 2 per package. This is my opinion only. This is the one I prefer. Again, I have no relationship with them. This is what the Esvio looks like. It's usually given to ambulance drivers. It's kept in high-risk locations. You will not generally get this. This is the one that you can get. You can actually buy this at and some places, depending on the situation, you may get your insurance may cover you on this. It's provided as a two-pack for obvious reasons. It's too short acting. So you want to be able to give that second dose if you need it. Now, I apologize in advance. If you do not want to watch this, please turn away. It's a couple minute, 2 minute video. It shows an individual being revived by police officers. So this is an actual overdose situation. It's not available to the general public, but I will share this with you right now. So if you want to turn off your screen, there's not a lot of audio. There's a little bit. You can hear the police officers going back and forth. Unfortunately, you can't hear the rails so well. What I want you to do is I've circled. If you want to watch, look up here. There's a timestamp up here, and you can see how rapidly this works.
Let me pull them out. On the ground.
Oh, there you can.
Sir.
Did you hear the rasp? There it is. I forgot. You can hear it. I've got the volume turned way up.
What's his medical history?
I don't know.
They just picked him up 10 minutes ago.
You just picked him up?
Yeah. He's like, I need some money. Can you put me to work? And I said, yeah.
He's got a pulse. He's breathing, so.
Can you grab gloves?
He's not breathing. Flashlight. I can't see his eyes. Yeah, they're pinpoint.
All right, we've got the pinpoint pupils. We've got the rasps. He's not breathing. 911 has been called. Obviously, they responded. Sometimes that move right there will stimulate breathing. It's trying to stimulate the nerves underneath the sternum.
Go left nostril.
There's Narcan being administered. 1426 is the time.
Narcan deployed in the left nostril.
1914-36.
Is mine? Is mine?
No, it's just the one. 1415. That's good. They might get here before you.
1917. 3 minutes in, right?
Put it on.
They're going to start bagging them here. So they're assisting with the respiration. You can hear the emergency vehicles coming now.
All right. Take it off.
Controversial. Again, my opinion about this, whether or not the lay public should have naloxone. I'm erring on the side of agreeing with the people, but I want to make sure that people understand that if you administer Narcan at home, make sure that the person who received it goes to the ER, because we need to make sure that they're covered. That single dose of Narcan will not last that young man more than about 30 minutes, so he does need to go. And here's some details about the prescriptions. Again, it is available. I already checked it at my local CVS. I can get it. You can get it as well. You can have it on board. And so there is a movement now. Some states require naloxone to be co-prescribed with opiates. That is an interesting movement because they're recognizing the danger of giving opiates out and not giving a potential antagonist that could save somebody's life in case of an overdose. And I already said this. Does Narcan work on fentanyl? Yes. But you got to be careful. A single dose won't always do it. And so you might need that second dose. All right, last few minutes. I want to share with you I titled this having that fentanyl talk with your team. You can introduce a number of different drugs here. Many of these things are similar across drug classes, but I've tried to tailor it towards fentanyl. Please, please, please do not assume that your child already knows the dangers of drug and alcohol use and abuse. And more importantly, they might have heard stuff from their friends and it's just darn wrong. Trust me, I've heard it all. I cannot believe the stories that they're out there of what these drugs really do or what they don't do. And sometimes they get erroneous information from older brothers or sisters. And sadly, sometimes they get the wrong information from their parents. That's why I'm so thrilled that you're here with me today. The whole goal here is to empower you with the actual facts, not hearsay, not innuendos, not stuff on Bob's big boy website on all you want to know about fentanyl. Please do not let them get their information there. Why is it important? Your child may think they're taking a prescription quality, legally manufactured drug like OxyContin, Xanax, or Percocet. And I think I've already made that point. I'm making it again. This is what you can convince them with. They cannot rely. You buyers beware. You are never certain of what that drug is when you buy it on the street. And in fact, if it's the first time they've ever been exposed to opiates, that's when they go to ground. That's when they have an overdose. And it's very hard to revive somebody from a very high dose of opiates. All right, some general guidelines. Start talking when they're young. The time to start talking to your children when they turn 18, 19, 20, and they're on their way off to college is a little late. I have five daughters. I started the talk just before puberty with all of them. Now, I didn't show them the really graphic stuff here. It's age appropriate, but you want to build a relationship with them. Plan to have multiple conversations. Do not try to cover everything. Do not try to unpack everything that we have learned tonight in a single conversation. It will take time and it's worth it. Choose some informal times. Don't set a date and say, all right, in 4 days, we're going to have the talk. That just causes all sorts of anxiety. Try to do it nonchalant. And please resist the urge to lecture to them. Also, you need to listen. If they think for a moment that you're judgmental, they will tune you right out. And your goal right now is to impart in them the knowledge that you have. You got to be empathetic and supportive. Remember, up until they reach puberty, you are their heroes. Trust me, they look up to you for everything. The moment they reach puberty, all bets are off. Their peers become very, very important to them, and in some cases, more important to their parents. Now, those of you, I have grandkids now, and I have a 42-year-old daughter. They come around, so there's hope, folks. They will love you again. But during puberty, don't talk to me about that. We all go through that. But being an active listener, be empathetic. Have an exit plan. If things get too dicey, say, look, we need a timeout. We'll come back. We'll talk about it when you're ready. Be prepared to discuss family history of drug use. If they ask you point blank, well, gee, mom, gee, dad, did you drink alcohol when you were in college? Got to be honest with them. It's okay to do that. But it's also important to understand how to use these drugs responsibly, because they are going to try them, folks. They are going to try them. And please let them know that prescriptions can be harmful. Just because they're a prescription, just because a doctor gives it out to somebody, does not mean it's completely safe. Now, for the younger children, straight and factual conversations about fentanyl. Let them know that taking pills, use words like Russian roulette. You can use any kind of phrase. What starts out to be an experiment or a fun time can end up very dangerously. Ask your teen if what they know. That's a good starting point. In fact, with my own kids, I kind of did that. So what do you know about fentanyl? What do you know about marijuana? What do you know about crack cocaine? I'm just curious. I'd love to know because, you know, when I was a kid, I didn't have this. Or I want to share my stories with you, what I knew, what was going on. They will see you as an ally here, and they'll be more likely to open up and tell you what they know. And then don't immediately jump down and say, oh my God, I can't believe you know that. Yeah, I can't believe you believe that. What an idiot. Do not react like that. Your reaction should be, wow, that's fascinating. I never heard that before. Well, you know, in fact, I know of a site that's on the National Institute on Drug Abuse that actually counters that. And would you be willing to look at that with me? Because we could learn together. We could learn together that that's not actually what these drugs do or there's a hidden danger here that maybe both of us can learn from. If you engage with them like you're going to learn along with them, that you are invested in that, that goes a long way for them trusting you. Do not judge them. I know it's going to be tough sometimes, and you got to maintain calm, practice with your soulmate there. You know, do some role playing. What would you say if your son or daughter says this? Be prepared for that and let them know that they can talk to you. You do not want them going to their friend's older brother or older sister to get their information about drugs. You definitely do not want that. Guaranteed it's wrong. Now, what if you suspect or know that your son or daughter is already using? Having a talk is even more urgent. Please do not be vague. Give them a chance to explain. Sometimes it's serious peer pressure. Sometimes they want out. Sometimes they're looking for you to be the police there. They're looking for you to ground them and say, you can't go out with so-and-so anymore. Sometimes that's what they need. They need you to intervene. Be totally honest. Be prepared to discuss that peer pressure. Peer pressure is just horrific, guys. It's so horrific. It has an impact. I don't know whether you remember when you were kids. I remember it was crazy when I was a kid. Stay educated yourself. You're doing that tonight. Continue to learn. I'm still learning, folks. There's not a day that doesn't go by that I don't pick up something new. So keep educating yourself. Remain vigilant of your child's genetic risk factors, including any mental health issues. Sometimes the use of opiates is an attempt to self-medicate for a term that I call mental anguish. It is a subset of depression. There's depression and then there's mental anguish where people just cannot feel pleasure. And these opiates can can release that sometimes. Many times these drugs of abuse are attempts to self-medicate. Keep the pipeline open. And I'm recommending you keep at least 2 doses of Narcan if you know your child is actively using fentanyl or other opiates. It's available without a prescription in all these pharmacies, and many insurance policies will take it. Be proactive. It is a protective factor. It is not an endorsement of substance use. Please be careful, be mindful of that, because that is one of the biggest arguments that the federal government has been promulgating. And people who are against the release of Narcan to the lay public, they're claiming that you are endorsing substance. You're not. You're protecting someone you love, because right now they need help. And it is a disease. It's a DSM-5 characterized disorder. It's a psychiatric disorder, substance use disorder. It's called OUD, opiate use disorder. It is really there. If you've not already checked, seek out local resources, get a therapist involved, get a counselor involved. Asking for help is tough, but professionals are out there. They'll start that relationship and help you with this. And lastly, I'll leave you with this sobering message of carfentanil. I think it might be the next bigger tsunami. I've had 2 cases now, 2 lawsuit cases where carfentanil was found in a batch of heroin. So far, I've only seen it in heroin batches, but I think it's not long that you're going to see it come back. It's under the brand name Wildnil. It's an opiate analgesic. It's used in veterinary medicine. It's used to anesthetize elephants and bears, folks. It is 10,000, you heard me correctly, 10,000 times more potent than morphine and 100 times more potent than fentanyl. And it's showing up disguised as heroin. And just in case you forget how big an African elephant is, I thought this was fun. 10,000 pounds versus the average team, maybe 140 pounds. Do the math. Do the math. And here's another. Now I'm using a dime. Sorry. I'm using Roosevelt here. Here's a heroin lethal dose. Here's that fentanyl lethal dose, 1 to 2. And here's carfentanil, 0.02 milligrams. So thank you very much. I'm going to stop sharing.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lucas. We're so happy to have had you out. And I know that people may have some questions. This is a time for you to tap your questions in the chat. And Dr. Lucas is willing to stay for a few minutes and answer any questions you might have. There was a lot of great information, and we're grateful to you for the tremendous amount that you've shared with us tonight, as well as the strategies, the concrete strategies for talking to our youth. As I'm waiting for other folks to maybe type something in the chat, I'm wondering, can you say a few words about fentanyl being in other substances? So a teen goes out and they think they might be smoking pot or they might be using a different type of pill, and then there's some contamination with fentanyl. Do you have any idea of how pervasive that might be, or any words of wisdom around that to share?
Yeah, so far we're not seeing it show up so much in marijuana. I've only know of a couple of very, very rare cases where fentanyl has been introduced into raw marijuana plant material. It is almost exclusively right now either being sold as fentanyl, as a powder, or as a lookalike drug where it's being sold as OxyContin or something else and pressed into those pills. That's very common right now. We're seeing an awful lot of that. And you saw those baggies that I showed you? They've confiscated like 100 of those bags. So you can imagine each one of those weighs about a half a kilo. That's a lot of fentanyl that's being produced and being sold and transported into this country. So it is much more pervasive to find those tablets. So that little blue tablet with those kind of imprints. But again, the imprints can mimic anything.
So I'm just looking at this. Okay, people are asking if these slides are available. This is being recorded, and I will be able to get the recording out to people. Any questions from anyone in the audience? We've taken a lot in. It's a lot to digest. One follow-up. I want to caution parents. It's not the kids have to go out and get things on the street corner anymore. You can go online.
Right.
And so it could be delivered directly to your house. You want to be really having these discussions and be aware and attuned to what's coming in the mail, what might be being delivered directly to your home. It's just a word of caution because there's a lot, it's a new world. And I think when we speak about our use in the past, when we were kids in high school or college, the substances that are out there are so much different. The potencies are so much different. And so that's something also, they'll say, well, you made it. Well, careful, it's a whole new world.
It is a whole new world, yeah. Good, great point.
Yes. So thank you, Dr. Scott Lucas, for coming out tonight. And thank you to all of you for spending time this evening. I will be getting this recording done and sent off to you so you can review it and you can share it with others, because this is a really important area for us all to be up to speed on and having conversations with the youth that we care about, whether we're teachers in class or whether it's our own kids. So thank you all very much. And again, Dr. Lucas, thank you for your breadth and depth of information that you shared and all your energy and your commitment to this.
Very good. Well, thank you again for having me. I really do appreciate the opportunity to reach out to all of you. So I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone.